Hey, we're getting it up today. Greg, gonna wind up doing a load and a piece.
How long are you on?
16 this week. You should have seen yesterday. We picked up a safe full of money on Wheeler Street.
You get it open?
Yeah, we picked up an unexploded grenade on Luxembourg Avenue.
How'd you make the grenade go off?
We put it in a microwave. Somebody left out a perfectly good microwave oven on Grayson Road.
How'd you hook up the microwave?
We found a... Hey, what are you, the Spanish Inquisition? I'm just trying to get through my day here.
I'm just curious. Contemporary consumption and our habits of discarding have no historical precedent. I've come to see how, in a sense, we are anthropologists, bearing witness to one of humankind's great marvels.
I never thought of it that way. So what you're saying is that consumption is the mechanism we rely on to declare and recognize distinctions of class, education, and fundamental identity?
Yes, and we are its existential detectives. Capiche?
Huh. Someone should do a radio show about this. About the way garbage is a social commentary on this moment in human history. And now, the guy who called my supervisor to say he'd thrown out the wrong human head, Colin McEnroe.
That would be me. It was a mistake. I got it back. I got the one that I threw out back, and then they I threw out the right one. You don't know what you're going to find in the garbage. And we're going to talk about garbage today from a whole bunch of different perspectives. But one of the things we're going to do is talk very specifically to the people who do pick up your rubbish and your recyclables. We're going to talk to an anthropologist who spent quite a bit of time with workers like the one you heard in the introduction from the Department of Sanitation in New York City. But right here in studio with us, we also have Mike Payne. He is the third of four generation of Payne's Incorporated Recycling and Rubbish Removal. He'll be telling you a little bit about the reality of doing that job around here in Connecticut. But we're going to begin. I'm going to begin the conversation with Ed Humes. Ed Humes is a Pulitzer Prize-winning author of 12 books, including Garbology, Our Dirty Love Affair with Trash. And Ed Humes, first of all, welcome to the show. And second of all, one of the things that you say is that we probably tend to underestimate how much trash we actually, per human being in the United States, produces. Say a little bit more about that.
Sure. And hi, Colin.
Hi.
Yeah, we underestimate it because we're so good at making it disappear. We roll it out to the curb, and we have these amazing waste management workers and technology who are really good at what they do, and it creates the illusion that our trash is being taken care of and made to disappear, but really it's just out of sight, and we are bad at measuring it. The EPA publishes statistics that are based upon very old mathematical models and that doesn't actually look at the amount of garbage we physically make. And it turns out we've been underestimating it for many years. And when Columbia University and a journal called BioCycle began actually measuring the amount of material going into the nation's landfills, which carefully weigh every pound because that's how they make their money. They charge by the pound. They found out that we were making almost twice as much trash as the official statistics led on. Instead of 4.5 pounds per person per day, the average American was making over 7 pounds.
And a lot of people are listening to us and thinking, well, that's not me. I mean, someone listening to this show is thinking, well, I can even just add up in my mind how much garbage I produce every way. No way is it 7.1 pounds. And obviously, that's an average, so they might be right about that. But if they're underestimating, how are they underestimating? Why won't that click with them cognitively?
Well, I think it's because we don't have to look at it. You know, I purposely started my book with this scene of hoarders who had accumulated all their trash in their house. It was an elderly couple in Chicago, and they hadn't thrown anything away. They felt all their material was a treasure, and they literally, within 2 years, were buried alive and had to be rescued from their own trash. And when they weighed the material that came out and hauled it away, it turned out they made exactly the amount of trash the average American makes. It was a great visual representation of the mountains each of us accumulates. And it's very hard to keep track of, but if you look at what our trash is made of, you see that the biggest category are packaging and containers. That's the biggest part of our trash, and that's the part that's grown exponentially in the last 30, 40 years. And it's the stuff that we buy and immediately throw away. So, of course, we're not even aware of it anymore.
I'm going to throw this over to Mike Payne. I think this is probably going to square up pretty well with his perspective. But just to give you some perspective on the Payne's company, they were started in 1929 by Albert Payne. As I said, Mike is the third of four generations working in the company. So, Mike, you've had an opportunity over the course of your life, and certainly even longer over the course of Payne's history, to see some of these patterns change. You just heard Ed Humes talking about packaging. Is that one of the areas of growth in terms of what you guys are picking up now?
Absolutely, Colin, and thanks for inviting me in today. It's the packaging that we all get that we bring home our batteries in, or in anything that we buy, we have to then get rid of, whether it's the material wrapping your food or your crackers or your bread or any of those kind of things. And it all just accumulates, and we don't really think of it in many ways. It's amazing. When I go to the grocery store, I get rid of my plastic bags that, my dry cleaning comes back in and all that stuff. And it's amazing how quickly I'm filling that bag that I then carry into the grocery store with to buy stuff. And it's all of those little things that we really don't necessarily see, or it's not right in front of us.
You also, I think, grew up to a certain degree in a farming culture, so you've probably also seen a transition in terms of how we consume food. Increasingly, food is sold in individual portions. Talk about how that affects the waste stream.
Sure. The food that, two generations ago, we used to grow most of our own food or then buy large packaging, packaged items. Now, pretty much everything is set up either for a single serving or for a single meal. And so we then have all that material to then get rid of. And frankly, there's more food waste because it spoils much quicker. We're not bringing home the big packages of much of the canned food and everything that, frankly, I grew up on.
By the way, if you have questions as we go along here or comments, we'd love to hear from you. We're live here in the afternoon, so give us a call, 860-275-7266. That's 860-275-7266. So Ed Humes, obviously some of this trash goes into landfills. That's where the trash is. I assume, Mike, everything that you take to a landfill. I mean, the stuff that's not recycled anyway, right?
Actually, Connecticut's actually the leader in the nation. We're over 85% of our waste doesn't go to a landfill. It actually goes to what they call waste to energy, so it gets burned and generates electricity.
So CRRA and stuff
CRRA,
like that.
Other facilities like that.
All right. So, but Ed Humes, where does the garbage go? Does it stay in our country even, or does it go other places?
Well, yeah. First of all, let me say that Connecticut really has been a leader in that area because the national average is about 69% of our stuff goes to landfills. So. Connecticut's way ahead of the game there. But yes, you're right. What we don't send to the landfill and what we don't recycle, it turns out we're exporting. And in fact, it's one of America's leading exports right now is our trash, our scrap paper and metal and electronic waste and the stuff we really don't want to deal with here. We've been outsourcing, not just our jobs, but our trash too. And it turns out by volume, it's our biggest export. It's the biggest thing we make, our trash, and that's pretty much the product other countries have up until fairly recently wanted from us. Now, China, among the countries that import our trash, is finally saying, I think we've had enough of this. Find someplace else to dump your stuff. We don't want so much of it anymore because there's a huge toxic and environmental cost to some of the waste that we're sending abroad. So we may have to start finding another solution. But it's one of the few reasons all the containers going out of places like the Port of Los Angeles are not completely empty when they're going back across the Pacific. They're getting filled up with trash. And in California, that's the second leading export, not just in volume, but in terms of dollars.
As we go along here, we're going to explore very specifically the lives of the people who do pick up the trash, both Mike Scruz and Robin Nagel, who actually is an anthropologist who studied the Department of Sanitation in New York, Cruz, and who worked on them as well, qualified to work on them and did work on them as well. That's all coming up in a little bit. And also, we're going to tell you a little bit more about what can be recycled and what can't. Mike can give you kind of a sense of what the realities of that are here in Connecticut. We'll also talk about what theoretically could be recycled that's not and how we could actually change our consumption patterns a little bit to to produce less waste. And Ed has some thoughts about that. But before we do that, Ed, one of the things we occasionally see pictures of or hear about is the so-called Great Pacific Garbage Patch, this garbage that's kind of floating out in the middle of the ocean. Is that our garbage? Whose garbage is out there?
Well, it's kind of a global problem, but as one of the major producers of plastic waste in the world, certainly a big portion of it is ours. It's a bit of a misnomer. People picture this sort of floating landfill out at sea, but the real problem is the plastic pieces that end up washed down our rivers and into the ocean or lost overboard, break up into small bits of plastic rather than large pieces of floating debris. And why is that a problem? Because although it doesn't decompose, the waves and the weathering makes these little brittle pieces of plastic out of our plastic waste, and it resembles and is the size of plankton. So it enters our food chain. Fish that eat plankton as their main source of nourishment gobble up the plastic and other toxins that cling to the plastic. And so we have this problem of our food chain being contaminated by our plastic waste because, of course, bigger fish eat those plankton eaters and still bigger fish eat them, and then we eat those fish. So it's a huge and as yet not fully understood problem.
You know, Mike Payne, New York City, which you don't serve, spent $2.2 billion on sanitation in 2011. You're in a position to see what municipalities are spending on this, and you're also in a position to see what it costs your company to haul all this stuff around. Does it bother you how much trash there is? I mean, you're in the trash business, so if there weren't any trash, you'd have to find something else to do with your life. But how do you see it all?
I actually look at it two different ways, and part of, while the biggest export out of many of the harbors is material going to China, I look at it as recyclables versus trash.
Mm-hmm.
And to me, recyclables are things that someone then makes into another product.
Mm-hmm.
The paper and stuff, there's a desire for that. And anybody who's bought stuff that came back from overseas typically sees a very yellow cardboard, and that's actually cardboard that's been bleached out. That's why it's yellow. So I actually see it as a good thing that we separate those two categories. But yes, it continues to evolve. Mm-hmm. And as they find new and better uses for the different materials, hopefully we're going to continue to take more material out of the trash barrel, if you will, and put it in the recycle bucket.
All right. And as towards the end of the show today, we'll talk very, very specifically about all that. As I say, our number, 860-275-7266, 860-275-7266. Why don't we take a little break here? When we come back, we're going to add Robin Nagel. We're going to talk to Robin and Mike about the kind of realities of picking up the trash.
Who can take your trash out? Stomp it down for you. Shake the plastic bag and do the twisty thingy too. The Garbage Man.
Oh, the Garbage Man can.
All right, we're talking about garbage today. We got some calls coming in. In just a second, also, Ed Humes is going to stay with us, and he'll tell us a little bit about MIT's project. I think we've talked about this before on our show, their trash tracker project, where they actually do try to figure out where trash really goes. But before we get there, we've got Robin Nagel here with us. She is the author of Picking Up on the Streets and Behind the Trucks with the Sanitation Workers of New York City. And also with us, as I said, Mike Payne, the third of four generations at Payne's Rubbish and Recycle, or actually Recycling and Rubbish Removal. Robin Nagel, first of all, welcome to the show.
Thank you.
And, you know, let's sort of start on the kind of dangerous job end here. There's a section in your book where you're talking about how, I think it was when Mike Bloomberg was first running for the mayor of New York, he said that you could make a case that sanitation workers have a more dangerous job than firefighters or policemen. A lot of people thought this was kind of a gaffe. You beg to differ, right? You think a case could be made for the fact that this really is the most dangerous job in the city?
It's not even that the case can be made. It's just a fact. According to the Bureau of Labor Statistics, which measures job hazards across all categories, sanitation work is regularly ranked in the top 10 most dangerous jobs list, and police and firefighting are nowhere near that. And when I make this point, I'm always careful to be very clear that I mean no disrespect to our cousins in police and firefighting departments, but I do think it's really important that the larger public and sanitation workers themselves recognize that the job is a very dangerous, it's a very dangerous work for several different reasons.
And, you know, when we get to those reasons, too, I mean, one of the things that, you talk about in your book is I think when you were being trained about how to handle the bags, you were actually, they trained you in a way that, in, or the guidelines were sort of different from the reality, right? That, in, there were some kind of guidelines that said you could kind of brace the bag against your body, but the people you were working with said, don't ever do that.
Well, the old way, they're fascinating training manuals from back in the day, like the 1940s and 50s, that show guys balancing tubs of garbage on their heads or their hips or their shoulders. But in the current era when we put so much of our garbage in plastic bags, garbage pokes through plastic bags. And to have it come into contact with your body at all is a good way to risk getting cut or punctured or hurt in a variety of ways.
Mike Payne, you're over there nodding and gesticulating. So talk a little bit about how you see the risks for sanitation workers.
She's absolutely correct. You never want to use your legs or pick up the bag. I've been poked and maybe not stabbed, but definitely punctured with things coming through the bags. And we've actually evolved where now we do fully automated collection, which is where we give our customers a barrel. They put the material in the barrel and a truck mechanically empties that. So we've gotten our folks away from that. But she was also, Robin was actually correct that we're typically in the top five most dangerous, according to the Bureau of Labor Statistics, jobs. And not that we all don't want our folks to not be safer, but we keep working on that and trying to get that number farther down the list.
The I would assume there are other dangers as well. Mike, in my neighborhood, there's lots of dogs. Is that a problem for our sanitation workers?
Well, now that we're in the truck, it's a lot less of a problem. Yeah. But years ago, I had more than a couple dogs come after me thinking I was stealing something from the house. And actually, I was supposed to do it, but they wouldn't understand that. So, yes, it's a challenge. And the dogs running around, you know, that's a problem, too.
You know, Robin, one of the other things you get into in your book is that this is I think you use the phrase purposely unseen, you know, that this is in all the ways that Ed Humes was talking about in the first segment. This is an activity that, for the most part, people don't see. And even if they see it, they somehow or other kind of look through it. You talk about the experiences of John Coleman, who was the president of Haverford College, who took some time off and actually worked as a garbage man, and just sort of talked about the strange invisibility of it. It's real different, too. There's a lot of other people who help us, who serve us, who show up at our houses to do things. But there's some way in which we're almost not acknowledging the presence of these workers in their trucks. Can you say a little bit more about that?
You're quite right. And the invisibility it's learned, you know. I mean, they're there on the street in a big truck, and in New York City anyway, wearing a uniform. But they fall under a category of labor that is about maintenance. And maintenance workers in general, like, when's the last time you were in a building that had a janitor or a cleaning crew or a repair staff? And you probably kind of looked past them as well. So I think it falls into that bigger category. But then with garbage in particular, consider that when we let go of it, when we discard it, we don't want to have to think about it again. And that extends to the people whose job is taking it away, so that we don't want to have to think about them either. So the invisibility, I think, comes from a few different sources.
We're getting a lot of calls in here at 860-275-7266. Brooks and Bill and Elliot, we will get to your calls as quickly as possible. We're talking about garbage. And actually, let me see if I can get Brooks on the air here. I'm going to have to do a little juggling here on my board here. Let me see if I can get Brooks on the air right now, because it seems to be right on point. Here's Brooks in Manchester. Hi, Brooks.
How you doing?
Good. What's on your mind?
Hey, I work for the town of Manchester. We run a bulky waste landfill.
Mm-hmm.
And I know Mike Payne well. You got one of the best guys in the business on your show. Mm-hmm. But I just wanted to quickly comment that even at a landfill, we've done a lot in the past couple of years to try to recycle waste before it goes in to the landfill. We sort out all our clean pallets and we grind those up. Those are made into mulch. And we also divert a tremendous amount of organic waste to create compost. One other thing maybe Mike can comment about, which would be great for your listening audience, is that the state is really a leader in the product stewardship movement, where they've created programs to recycle difficult things that used to end up in the landfill, such as electronics. They've recently done it with paint, and moving forward, they're looking at mattresses. But there still is a place for landfills in the business, and it's a great show. I appreciate your coverage.
All right. Thanks very much, Brooks. Actually, we did a little bit with product stewardship on a show of ours a couple of weeks ago. We had actually Stephanie Winnuck from the Product Stewardship Institute, and we actually are going to – we're planning kind of a sequel to this show that will be about – compost. But just Mike, just to his point, in some ways anyway, landfills have gotten a little or maybe a lot more sophisticated in separating it out. And just the crunch of space, if nothing else, would make them have to figure this out.
Yes, absolutely. And it's also like everything else, it's evolved. You know, in the 80s, the federal government set up new criteria for landfills and began to phase them out because every town had their little corner where they had their own dump. Now they've gone to much bigger landfills. There is still stuff that you can't recycle and you can't burn, so you need to do something with it. Even the residue after the waste energy is called an ash landfill. So we still do need those facilities. Brooks is absolutely correct. But as we continue to pull more materials from the waste side of things and find new uses for them, like the mattresses and paint and everything, that's a good thing.
You know, Robin Nagle, your book is off about, first of all, the dangers, the hazards, the difficulties of being a sanitation worker, about the incredible pressure that's put on them during storms. Maybe we can talk with you and Mike about that in a little bit. But there are some – I mean, there's a reason that people do these jobs too. I mean, apart from having a job and a steady job and a job that pays, what are the rewards? What actually lures people to this job and keeps them in it?
Well, it's a job that provides a solid paycheck. In New York, after you are no longer at the base pay, you can earn a living wage. You also get a generous benefits package, and you can build a life. If you want to have a family, you know, raise kids, maybe buy a home, you can do that. And right now in New York City, you're only required to have a high school degree or its equivalent. And that kind of opportunity is increasingly difficult to find for people who don't go on to college. The other reason is that, and this makes it a legacy job a little bit, which surprises people. Who would want to be working in sanitation across generations, right? But in fact, there are fathers who then work with their sons when sons come on, and there are uncles and cousins and now daughters and sisters, because the camaraderie of the job and the satisfaction that people get from doing it well, and the really rock-bottom importance of the work to the city's daily well-being and its well-being across history, those are all powerful reasons to take the job.
You know, as we were getting ready for the show, one of the things I found was like on a Reddit feed in which people who worked in this field were discussing things that they had found. And a lot of the things that they had found were sort of grisly and frightening. I mean, there were, you know, descriptions, who knows how accurate this being Reddit, of severed legs and things like that. But I mean, you know, I think we also have this sense that if you work in sanitation, and maybe not so much for Mike's workers now because they're not getting out of the truck. It's all going into the truck, and this is all happening at a different point of the waste stream, which we'll talk about as we go along here. But Robin, I think, you know, there's a lot of folklore anyway about the idea that, oh yeah, they do. They find a safe, you know, and it's got money in it, or a cash register that somebody didn't empty out or something like that. I mean, how much of that is true? Are there spoils of war?
Sure, a lot. In New York, it's not legal to take any of that stuff, but when it's on the curb and it's been abandoned and there's nobody to claim it, it can be a temptation, especially if it is something like cash. That's pretty rare. Mm-hmm. But think of a very tightly packed population of 8.4 million people, and think of all the stuff that might pass through their lives that either intentionally or accidentally they let slip, they let go of, and then it's on the curb for anybody to claim. There's a lot of wealth on the street that is supposed to go into the back of a garbage truck, and sometimes it gets diverted.
Mike, it is true anyway that a lot of what gets thrown out is just garbage, and a lot of what's thrown out is things like packaging material, as we're saying. A lot of things that get thrown out though are theoretically usable. Or, I mean, what happens to that stuff? What's your firm's connection with the stuff that's thrown out that actually is intact and reusable?
To the extent we can, we try to find homes for stuff. When people call us for a bulk pickup, which is typically those bigger items, we tell them first, excuse me, to call the local, either put it on Craigslist, see if they can sell it there, or there's a couple recycle websites that are FreeCycle, like FreeCycle, where you can put them on there and people will come and take them, or talk to your neighbors or see if you can find somebody that needs those items. There are typically people at different levels than all of us that can find a home for that stuff because they have nothing.
Do you typically find thousands of dollars in the trash as well?
Not this week.
All right. all right, let me just grab a quick call here. I'm going to just pop Robin over here, bring back – I'm doing a little bit more juggling on the board than usual. Oh, I think I just lost Robin. I thought I did it the right way. I may have lost Robin. All right, so while we reclaim Robin Nagel, Bill from Watertown, I think you have a comment or a question. Yeah, go ahead.
Hello?
Hi, you're on the air.
Oh, hi. This is Bill from Watertown. A while ago, I heard on 60 Minutes a wonderful story about the city of San Francisco, where they've now developed a program where everything for any resident is to be recycled, that they've got a process now that they're consciously separating everything, putting it in the right locations, and minimizing the amount of actual garbage, that refuse that needs to be put or needs to be sent out. And if they exceed an amount of that, then they're fined for that amount. It's exciting to hear that they've got that in place, and I'm wondering if there's been any discussion or any consideration in your work elsewhere.
All right. Yeah, I think this is a good question for Ed Humes. So you just heard that call. I mean, who's doing this well?
Well, San Francisco definitely is one of the leaders in trying to achieve this so-called zero waste goal, where the community sends very little to the landfill. And the way they achieve that is to ramp up recycling. They also have a program of curbside compost material collection, so that your lawn trimmings and food scraps all go into a separate collection stream. And actually, they make a large amount of compost, and one of the chief consumers for that is the wine industry in Northern California, and they import that compost up a few miles up the state and make wine with its assistance. So that's a pretty cool way to close the loop on material that used to end up in the landfill. The other cool thing they do in San Francisco, and I spent a lot of time with these guys, are they have an artist-in-residence program at their dump. And so they actually pay these artists to go on these three-month tours of duty at the dump. And the only rule is they have to do their paintings or sculpture or whatever art they create out of materials and tools that get thrown away. It's a great public awareness thing because it gets to what you were talking about a minute ago, the incredible value of the materials that comes through there. Every kind of paint, brush, tool, and material that an artist or sculptor would need, they quickly find in short order. I mean, you have musical instruments showing up, sewing machines, all sorts of material that, people in other parts of the world would not consider to be trash at all, but that we routinely throw away. I saw pianos come through. I saw a load of last year's models, jacuzzi, getting dumped at one landfill I visited. Perfectly good stuff. I
want to pause you on that one and just sort of, because that was easy to gloss over, I think. You weren't talking about one jacuzzi, right? You were talking about
a load
of unused, never used jacuzzis.
Yes, exactly. Loads of produce. I mean, the material that gets thrown away isn't just trash, as you've already heard. It's material that has tremendous value that we're discarding, along with the more pernicious kinds of waste that nobody knows what to do with it. But a lot of it really shouldn't be thrown away at all. And there's room to repurpose, and there's a huge economic opportunity for individuals or companies that can reclaim the stuff before it gets landfilled. And that's what those artists are put in place to demonstrate.
Robin Nagel, as you studied New York sanitation, did you get a sense of the ratio between household waste and waste that comes from business? I mean, I think, on a show like this one, we talk a lot about household waste because that's what people come into contact with, and that's what people feel as though they can control. Do you have any kind of sense of what the split is?
Yes, and thank you for this question because it points to a really important issue. In New York City, municipal household waste is roughly a third of the total waste stream. The other third is commercial and business waste, and then the last third is what's called C&D, construction and demolition debris. But I want to point out here the bigger issue that I think is pretty vital. Municipal household waste nationwide accounts for approximately 3% of the total waste stream. So the picture is far bigger than just household trash. And one of the things that you did so well, Ed, in your book is talk about how these numbers are really kind of hard to nail down and who says what category of waste is called what and therefore where it goes and what regulations govern it and who gets to control what happens to it. And all of that is very dense. It's very politically layered. It has real consequences in the world in terms of the environmental impact of a whole lot of different kinds of waste. But I would love to see us begin to take this focus on waste and expand it to ask hard questions about things like manufacturing and extraction processes and what forms of waste stand before that what's called upstream we get, say, the plastic water bottle that then we recycle. So the municipal waste stream, it's really important, and we absolutely have to figure out a way to shrink it, but we need to look at a bigger picture at the same time.
We're going to take a little break here in just a second and talk a little bit more about this and talk in specifics about what can be recycled and what can't. I'm really embarrassed because I actually have a plastic water bottle in here, but I do also have a glass water bottle that I usually use. This is sort of a worthwhile point. And so, Ed Humes, just while we're on that and while she's just said that, I mean, I think a lot of people listening to what she just said would be thinking, wow. Maybe it doesn't really make any difference at all whether I wash out my yogurt container or not and recycle it. I mean, if we're 3% of the whole stream, how much of an impact can the individual person have on this problem if we're going to identify it as a problem? I know.
You don't didn't go there. That's not
no, well,
but I think a lot of people, Robin, heard what you said and maybe thought that. So let's talk about it.
Yeah, well, there's an easy answer for that. First of all, it hugely matters. But one thing we're obsessed with is trying to figure out what to do with the trash. When the first question needs to be, why are we making so much of it, and what can we do about that? It's not where to put it. It's not whether to recycle it or landfill. Is there a strategy that makes economic sense for making less waste in the first place? Now, what drives our industrial manufacturing waste? Consumers drive it. So it's not just what consumers do with what they throw away. It's the choices they make in how they purchase things. And then layer on top of that, you have these hidden subsidies that make a wasteful choice more economically viable than a less wasteful choice, whether it's subsidies for junk mail or excusing the manufacturers of wasteful products from having to clean up after themselves and foisting that off onto consumers and taxpayers. So, yes, our individual household waste is just a piece of a larger waste stream, but the choices we make as consumers are driving the whole train, and that's what we need to start paying attention to, creating incentives to be less wasteful rather than the system we have right now, which is kind of the opposite of the product stewardship you're talking about. We are rewarding wastefulness in ways that really don't make economic sense.
Robin, did you want to elaborate on that? I did. I heard your cri de coeur there.
Yes, thank you. I really don't want listeners to think, well, heck, if it's such a small piece of the picture, what does it matter if we recycle our yogurt containers? It matters a lot because curbside recycling is one of the ways in which we have learned how individuals and consumers, but more activists and people who are politically engaged can really make a difference. Curbside programs mostly started back in the 60s and 70s because a whole lot of people got fed up with the kind of garbage, the quantities of it that we were making, and said, let's do something about this. And it became, over time, a nationwide practice that we quite rightly celebrate. The next step is to build on that and bump it up to another level, bump it up so that we're requiring manufacturers to have the same accountability and responsibility for their wastes that consumers are right now supposed to have.
All right,
So I don't think we should. I mean, that yogurt container, absolutely, you have to recycle it because you got it. It's like it's a momentum that will make a tremendous difference going, already has, and will continue to make an even bigger difference going forward.
All right. We're going to take a quick break here. And I do recycle the yogurt containers, by the way. Actually, I've got all of my household recyclables. I mean, I've got a bag of my household recyclables right here in the studio. I'm going to, when we come back from the break, we're going to talk to Mike Payne a little bit about, you know, what can be recycled, what can't. We talk to our other guests about what should be recycled that isn't. And Dave from West Hartford, you're the perfect caller to put on the air. Stay on the line right now.
All the contents of today's show will be recycled into other radio shows. Today's show was produced by Patrick Scahill, Betsy Kaplan, and me, with help from our intern Garrett Connolly. Voiceover help in the intro by Greg Hill. The part of Bill Curry was played by Alfred P. Doolittle. On tomorrow's show, a gathering of state troubadours. And now, back to Colin.
Yeah, several states have state troubadours. We are one of them, and we are going to. We have a new one, a brand new, freshly minted state troubadour. You'll meet her and at least three former state troubadours tomorrow, and we'll all gather together in the studio here. Also, want to quickly mention tonight, I will be a panelist at Asylum Hill Congregational Church for a League of Women Voters forum, which is all about transparency in government, specifically some things that have happened in Connecticut here regarding the FOI statutes or regarding watchdog agencies within state government. And we'll probably explore some national questions, too. Some of the other panelists include Dennis Horgan and former Congressman Rob Simmons. I forget who else. And Irene Papoulos, the amazing Irene Papoulos, will be the moderator. So anywhere, everybody's invited, as far as I know. It starts at 7 o'clock. You ought to join us for that. We're talking about garbage today. I want to talk a little bit about recycling. We got Dave from West Hartford on the line with a great call. But before that, let me just first of all remind you who's here. Mike Payne is here from Payne's Incorporated. They are a recycling and rubbish collection company. Serve, I think, about 60,000?
60, almost 70,000.
Almost 70,000 customers here in Connecticut, a four-generation business, a four-generation family business. Ed Humes is with us. He's Pulitzer Prize-winning author of 12 books, including Garbology, Our Dirty Love Affair with Trash, and the soon-to-be-released A Man and His Mountain, which is not about trash or landfills. It's about Jess Stone Street Jackson, the founder of Kendall Jackson Wines. A certain amount of my recycling material is wine bottles, but a lot of them I just pick up off the street. Those aren't actually wine bottles that I completely consume. Professor Robin Nagle is here, whether she's director of the Department of Anthropology at NYU, the author of several books, including this fascinating book, Picking Up on the Streets and Behind the Trucks with the Sanitation Workers of New York City. Mike Payne, before we go back to the other guests, in terms of the recycling that you do, and I don't know how much it varies from town to town, what can be recycled and what can't, but just what are some basic rules of thumb? But I think plastic is the thing that people find the most confusing. So what can be recycled and what can't?
Yes, Colin. The biggest confusion, if you will, with the plastics are that now it's 1 through 7 mm-hmm. plastics in almost every single town. Maybe there's some areas down toward the shore that don't do it, but it's 1 through 7 plastics. It's they're actually 9 or 10 mandated items by the state of Connecticut. Plastics is on there, papers, newspaper, junk mail, basically any kind of clean paper that doesn't have food waste on it, cardboard, waste oil, which should not go in your blue barrel, mm-hmm. the leaves, which shouldn't go in your blue barrel, but pretty much everything else, glass, tin cans, aluminum cans, any kind of food container, as long as it's cleaned off that meets those criteria, can go in there. And it's amazing how much stuff people are now recycling versus 2 years ago, 5 years ago, 10 years ago.
I think I'm about to lose an argument in my house. I've been sort of convinced that my significant and other, I often discuss what can go in recycling and what can't. And I've been convinced that she had a much more expansive notion of what's recyclable than what really is. Some of the things that Mike Payne just said have made me think I was wrong. But I've actually got, this is my bag of recycles right here. So, like, here's a box that tea comes in. This is a box of Tazo tea. It's not corrugated or anything. It's just a cardboard box. Can I recycle that?
Yes.
I can.
It's actually made from newspaper. They actually shred it up and flatten it.
So these are the plastic boxes that Driscoll strawberries come in. I can recycle those, right?
I believe so. They're probably –
Now, for what people need to do is they look.
Seven.
You have to look for that little triangle there, right? The little
right.
thing on the bottom. And if they're all stacked up, you can't read it. I'm pretty sure that it is either a 5 or a 7, though.
Yeah.
All right. How about
We got, look at that wine bottle. No.
There's an olive oil bottle down in there. I pulled all the wine bottles out before I came in here. So here's the tin foil that goes over a top of Caesar's filet mignon and meaty juices, canine cuisine. I would like to say I'm not responsible for buying this either. But so can that be recycled?
The aluminum can.
There you go. How about the plastic?
Should be. That's probably like a 3 or 4.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, there it is. It's a 7, actually.
It's a 7. Okay.
That still makes it, though.
Still makes it.
All right. I give up. More things can be recycled than I actually thought.
Welcome to my world.
Let's not mention this conversation to anybody else here. Let me grab a call here from Dave in West Hartford. Hi, Dave. Dave, you're on the air.
A couple of observations and a question. This show reminded me of an anthem, maybe a recruiting thing that Spanky and our gang put out in the 60s about trash collectors. In San Francisco, they have made plastic bags like you get from grocery stores here illegal.
Mm-hmm.
And now the question. My son worked for a recycling firm in California. They were interested in any plastic that had been connected to an electric wire because they were trying to recycle them into engineering plastics that could compete with raw material. And they had two plants, one in China and one in Austria. And I asked him when they were going to have one in the United States. And he said, we just don't sort it well enough for it to be economically feasible for them. Now, this was probably 5 years ago when he left that company to start a company filling wine bottles for you, Colin. and then one question I have beyond that is black plastic not to be recycled? I'll hang up and listen
all
to
right.
your answer.
Would you like to hum the Spanky in our game? All I can remember is, I remember Sunday morning. But that doesn't have anything about trash workers in it. No, it's got to be a different song. All right.
It's a different song.
Different song. I don't know if you wanted to comment on any of the things that he asked about. I'm going to throw Robin and Ed up here, too.
See, the one I'm most familiar with is the black plastics. Again, if it's the 1 through 7 and it's clean, it can go in your recycling. I don't know about the plastic bags and hooking them up to electrical wires. I'll leave that to Ed.
Well, you know, Ed Humes, one thing that the caller did talk about is other countries that maybe are doing a slightly better job than this. I don't know how that squares up with what you found in your research for garbology.
Well, most other developed countries do better than us, particularly in Europe and Japan, notably recycle at much higher rates than we do. Landfill. Little or, you know, in case of Germany and Austria, next to nothing, like 1% or less, and make energy out of what they can't recycle. So Denmark has achieved energy independence in part through its waste-to-energy and heating program. So a lot of cool things going on with other methods, none of which are perfect, but certainly more effectively than here. Plastic bags are an interesting one because they're theoretically 100% recyclable, but in practice only about 5% of them get recycled. They're just hard. Most recycling machinery kind of gets tangled up from the plastic films and unless they're specially designed to handle them. And what comes out at the other end is not worth much. You can't do that much with it. You can't make new plastic bags out of old plastic bags. You can use a little bit of it, but it's not strong enough after it goes through recycling. So depending on the type of plastic, there's real challenges for making things out of them. Last time I checked the list of things you can't recycle in New York City, I was surprised that plastic utensils were on the list of things that weren't going to be recycled, whether you put them in the right place or not. Maybe that's changed recently, but as of a couple of years ago, that was one of the we're not going to recycle a thing. Plastic foam, styrofoam, is another big problem area. It's very hard to recycle and do anything useful with or economically viable with.
Can I jump in?
Yes, please do, Robin.
The recycling rules in New York changed recently. Within the last 6 months, all plastics now except film plastic, that is plastic bags, all plastics are recyclable.
Yay.
Styrofoam is a different issue, but right now the cap of the soda bottle, the yogurt container, the plastic utensil, the deli ware from, you know, takeout restaurants, it all goes in recycling now. And the city has just rolled out a couple of compost organic food waste pilot programs that look very interesting. Those of us who watch this closely are very eager to see how that unfolds.
Mike Payne, we're just talking about styrofoam. That is a lot. We buy a lot of stuff. Increasingly, some of it's in those kind of air-filled plastic bags for cushioning. Mm-hmm. But you still get stuff shipped to you with a little styrofoam beanies or the hard styrofoam stuff. Is there anything you can do with those things?
There's nothing we've found we can do with it consistently, and that's one of the challenges. That's probably one of the last kinds of plastic that we'll get to, because a lot of it is already formed when it gets to you. Now what do you do with it if you can't shred it? Or there are balers where you can bale it up, but you kind of need a whole lot of styrofoam to make a bale of it.
Yeah. Okay, I'm going to do one of my juggling things where I'll probably lose the guest again, but maybe I won't. Here's Elliot in Hamden with a question. Hi, Elliot.
Hi. Thank you for having me on. There's a lot I could ask, but I'll try to be brief. My first question is, well, mostly I would just like the speakers to comment on trends in electronic waste.
Yeah, I think that's
I know that today with the rapid pace of technological innovation, we're seeing a lot more e-waste, and it's particularly, I know it can be hard to deal with and also quite environmentally damaging. And then I guess my other question was more systemic, and I was just wondering whether the speakers could comment on whether sort of our capitalist, consumer-driven system, how much that contributes to the waste we produce and the fact that we sort of...
We probably are, but you know what, Elliot, we probably won't have time for that second one. And we kind of touched on it a little bit here. We are just almost flat out of time. But I'm so glad that he did ask about e-waste. I'm going to very quickly see if I can get all three of you to give very short answers. Ed Humes, why don't you take it first? What do you see about e-waste complicating our garbage picture?
Well, two quick things. One is that on the good side, manufacturers have gradually been taking some of the more toxic elements of our e-waste out of their products, driven mostly by standards in Europe. So that's a good thing. It makes the e-waste slightly easier to handle. The downside is we're making everything smart, and making these smart chips, these silicon chips, is an incredibly wasteful process in terms of energy and materials used. So we think we're being more environmentally sound by getting paper out of the paperless office kind of thing. But it turns out that in the cloud might be even dirtier and more wasteful.
No. Robin, you want to give us 20, 30 seconds on e-waste?
Yeah, I kind of feel like e-waste today is where curbside recycling was 30 years ago. It might take a real push from committed, activist, engaged people to force larger systems to begin to really grapple with this. There are successful models in Europe that we could look to for examples, and some states have begun to step into this debate very fruitfully. So I think we have a bright future with it, but we really have to grapple with it.
All right. Mike Payne, you'll get the last word on e-waste.
E-waste. State of Connecticut passed a law a couple years ago. Everyone can recycle all of their electronic waste, anything with a cord, and they pretty much do it for no charge. Mm-hmm. It varies from town to town exactly how you get it picked up. But it's an incredible amount of material that is coming out of the waste stream that is now being recycled. And the state has approved vendors that are, if you will, pre-approved and vetted to make sure that they're handling stuff appropriately and not sending it out on a barge to somewhere it shouldn't go.
So would I do that through you if I live in West Hartford, or would I find somebody else?
West Hartford specifically has set up a vendor that you can take it to.
I can take it
to. If you check with your local town, if not... in some towns, Payne's does that collection for the town, but it varies from town to town.
What about CDs and DVDs and stuff like that? Can they be recycled?
The physical CD and DVDs, no, not that I'm aware of. But the cases are plastic.
Yeah,
those the paper is paper. And the players and all those again are electronics.
Yeah, I think there might be special places that do receive the CDs and DVDs. All right, that's all we have time for. Thank you so much, Mike Payne, Ed Humes, and Robin Nagel. We'll be back tomorrow singing. Maybe we'll sing a song about landfills.
Ragged or rotten or rusty, yes, I love trash.
I'm Kyone Wolf. Look at this perfectly good pasta dinner somebody threw away. Although it could be monkey's brains, although popular in Cantonese cuisine are not often to be found in Hartford, Connecticut. Yeah, that's pasta.